Hello there, you scrub lords, and welcome back to another episode of Lineups, where we discuss the best vehicles to bring in, well, your particular lineup for mostly tank RB. Today, in terms of vehicles, we're going to be discussing the British Tier 4 lineup, battle rating 6.0 to battle rating 6.7. So this is going to follow much the same pattern as the previous video, and if you are wondering why my voice sounds a lot different, it's because I am testing out the Sennheiser PC 350 headset microphone as opposed to my preferred Blue Yeti microphone. I have noticed that with the Blue Yeti, whenever I record a shadow play, which actually provides much better and much more consistent FPS, the Blue Yeti's microphone, for whatever reason, glitches out and sounds really, really scratchy and loses a lot of its quality with a shadow play. I'm not sure why that's totally the case. However, if you guys still prefer me to use the Blue Yeti, please let me know down in the comments section. And I wanted to get your opinion on one other thing before we get started. One of my subscribers asked me in the comment section of the last lineups video whether or not I would be doing some Verdun. I have done Verdun on some streams in the past, and I really quite like Verdun. I play it every now and then, sort of just like a casual thing, but if you guys would like to see some content like that on the channel, let me know down in the comment section, or if you want me to just stick to War Thunder, I am fine with that too. I can do either way. In any case, check out the poll in the top right-hand corner of the screen, and let me know your opinions on that one. Alright, now let's move on to the actual content. So, British Tier 4. Now, the British are one of those nations that you would think would be, to good players who can get the most out of them, are one of the most competitive nations in War Thunder. And I see on it's almost a daily thing on Reddit for War Thunder how the British suck, and the British are terrible, and you shouldn't grind them, and the British are horrible compared to the Germans, and they're horrible compared to the Russians, and they're horrible compared to the Americans. I see a lot of hate being pushed towards the British way, and some of that is legitimate. Some of that I can give that to some people, that the British are not for everybody. And the British are really for those players who know how to get the most out of their machines on a regular basis. So we're going to be discussing a few vehicles today, and we're going to start with the British 5.7 to 6... Well, there's really not much in the way of 6.0s, but you get my point. We're going to be starting with the initial rank 4. Now, the British don't really have a lot of what you would say as entry-level vehicles to Tier 4, much like the unlike the Germans, where they've got a whole lineup of 6.0 vehicles that you can bring into battle, or 6.3 vehicles you can bring into battle. The British only have a couple. And this is going to make things fairly simple and fairly straightforward, at least in the ground forces aspect. So you've got quite a few options here. Now, the first thing that a lot of people always do whenever they get into British Tier 4 is they go straight for the Carnarvon. And the reason why people go straight for the Carnarvon is, well, there's a lot less vehicles to unlock. There are two less vehicles, or actually three less vehicles, to get that 20-pounder gun and decent armor and mobility on the Carnarvon than the three vehicles you have to go through to get to the Centurion Mark III. And that's a very fair assessment. Now, however, there are a few vehicles in the British 6.7 lineup that need to be considered that aren't actually 6.7. Now, really, the initial break-in to the British Tier 4 that you can really call a Tier 4 is the FE4202. Now, I've already done a Super Unicorn review on this tank, and if you want to see my funny opinions on it, there's a link in the top right-hand corner where you guys can go see that video. However, for those of you guys who want kind of a more serious aspect, the FE4202, in my opinion, is a bit of a missed opportunity. The FE4202 has the potential to be an excellent machine. It's got ridiculously good turret armor. It's got 10 degrees of gun depression. It's got a 20-pounder gun. It's got pretty decent forward mobility. Actually, it's got Centurion-level mobility, which is actually more along the lines of a heavy tank than it is a medium tank. However, it's let down in two major areas, and that is the fact that, it does not get any APDS, despite the fact that this has the later variant of the 20-pounder gun with the fume extractor on it. The second issue with the FE4202 is its terrible reverse speed. That's an issue with all the British tanks up till you get to Tier 4, or with most vehicles up till you get to Tier 4 in the British line, where they've got decent forward mobility. Their maneuverability is not fantastic, but it works. However, the reverse speed is such that you have very, very large difficulties getting out of trouble once you get into it. You see this, especially on the Comet. The Comet is kind of like an initial taste of things to come, because it's the first British vehicle in their line to get APDS, or as the British called it at the time, SVDS, Super Velocity Discarding Sabo. And the Comet, like I said, is a bit of a taste of things to come. The Comet is an excellent vehicle once it's fully upgraded with APDS. It's got 12 degrees of gun depression, it's got decent maneuverability, forward mobility, but it's got horrible reverse speed. The Challenger, it loses a lot of its turret armor. It loses 2 degrees of gun depression, but you get the 17-pounder with APDS, which is technically the first vehicle by battle rating to get APDS on the 17-pounder. And that's really what sets the Challenger apart from the Comet. Is the fact that it gets 17-pounder with APDS that has slightly better armor penetration performance. Now, the more astute of you, or those of you who have been playing for a while, already know that the British theme is high penetration, rapid fire, but no explosive filler. So they're going to pick you apart, in some cases, one crewman at a time. And a lot of players really don't like that. And I can see why. For the average Joe, having to sit there and pick apart an enemy vehicle bit by bit is not exactly what you want to be doing, especially if the enemy especially if you're not that great of a shot, and the shell bounces or something like that, and you give the enemy the opportunity to engage you. The thing about the British is that I don't want to say they're glass cannons, because in a lot of cases they aren't. A few cases they aren't, and I'll get to those examples in the moment. However, you have to think of them as glass cannons. You have to learn not to rely on your armor most of the time when you're playing with the British. And the reason I say don't rely on your armor is not necessarily in the fact that you're not relying on your armor to incoming fire. What I'm talking about is your priorities should not be on your armor as much as it should be on your accuracy, your marksmanship, and your gun. Because the British guns, tier for tier, have the highest penetration of any of their counterparts. Now, obviously, there are exceptions to this rule, but this goes all the way back to tier 1 with the Crusader Mark III. The Crusader Mark III's 6-pounder gun has a penetration on its top rounds of 112 millimeters against flat armor. You can take out Tigers with this thing if you get close enough, and this is a 2.7 battle rating tank. This is a full 3.0 battle rating lower than the Tiger 1, and it can still kill the Tiger 1. At very close range, but it can still kill it. The trade-offs that you make with this are it has zero explosive filler, and you have no armor, or your armor is virtually ineffective. So what I'm trying to get at here is that the British are not for new players to the game. As much as you may, if you're from Britain and you're a new player joining the game, as tempting as it may be to go down the British line right at the start, I can't recommend it for new players. You need to know what you're doing if you want to get the most out of the British. I highly suggest a good starting point is the Russians. The Russians have a great set of starting vehicles to get used to the game, the basic game mechanics. You don't have to sit in front of a target forever. You just you one-shot them all the time. That's the sort of Russian play style. The Germans are much the same way once you get into Tier 2. However, their starting lineup is a little bit less appealing than the Russians. But they're also a good starting point. The Americans are kind of a jack-of-all-trades. I'll get to them in another video. So, again, those are the two... The Russians or the Germans are the two nations that I recommend playing first. I actually recommend playing both of them, to be honest, and figure out which one kind of suits your playstyle better. And then, once you've gotten through those to a significant degree and you've kind of figured the game out a little bit more, then start experimenting with a few other things. But I'm getting away from the real topic. So, what should you bring when you initially break into the British? Well, if you have the FV4 202, there could be a good argument to put that in your lineup. However, again, like I said with the Jagdpanther in the last video, it's one of those vehicles that you either love it or you hate it. And I really wanted to like this vehicle when it came out. However, it just has too many things that are not going for it, in my opinion. And I think if I'm going to be totally honest, I think the Challenger is actually a better vehicle. The Challenger's a lower battle rating, so you're not going to get as terrible matchmaking as the FV4 202, because the FV4 202 can face Jagdtigers. I mean, if FV4 202, despite that armor, a Jagdtiger at like 500 meters is going to punch right through your turret armor, no problem. And if he shoots at your hull armor, you're doomed at nearly 2,000 meters. So, like, the issue with the FV4 202 is that it's relying on your enemies to be stupid. It's one of those vehicles that is very, very good against new players, like against noobs, but against an experienced player, he will know exactly where to hit you, and he will hit you hard, and he will hit you over and over and over again until you're dead. That's the issue with the FV4 202. Combine that with the stock 20-pounder ammo, which is really bad. Well, in comparison to some guns, it's not terrible. The penetration's okay. The problem is that the post-pen damage for the solid shot 20-pounder, for whatever reason, is actually worse than the discarding sabot round, despite being a full-size caliber armor-piercing round. I'm not sure what the deal is with that, but regardless, my point still stands that the Shot Mark 1's armor-piercing round, or the 20-pounder's stock ammunition, is not very good, and it leaves a lot to be desired. Whereas, once you get through that, and once you get onto vehicles that actually have APDS, you start to realize the damage potential of these guns if you survived up to this point. Now, a lot of people hate this next vehicle, however, I'm going to recommend it, regardless, because personally I quite like it, and I think it's a very, very good vehicle, and that is the Charioteer. Now, the Charioteer, on paper, looks absolutely god-awful. It's essentially a Comet hull. You don't have the reverse speed to get out of trouble. You've got terrible armor on your turret and on your hull for its tier. Excuse me. And on top of that, you lose all your gun depression. You've only got 5 degrees of gun depression. What does this thing have going for it, though? Well, its forward mobility is really, really quite good. 57 kilometers an hour is nothing to sniff at. I don't know if it'll reach that 57 kilometers an hour, but it accelerates quite quickly, at least in going forward. Meaning that I like to think of this thing as sort of like a 20-pounder armed Hellcat at 6.3. Think of it as like a super Hellcat with armor-piercing discarding sabot with 283 millimeters of penetration. And because it's a British 20-pounder gun, you also get the advantage of having a very, very, very high rate of fire. 6.6 seconds is very good, and I think it goes down even further than that. Let me check real quick. 6.3 seconds is the top reload you can get on this thing. Now, without purchasing an Ace Crew, you get 6.6 seconds-ish. And that's with a fully maxed commander, a fully maxed loader, and expert crew. If you get an Ace Crew, then that goes down to the 6.3. But you get the point. And the Charioteer is one of those vehicles, much like the Hellcat, where if it gets spotted, it dies. Because it can't reverse out of trouble. The only way you can get out of trouble is to somehow go forwards and turn around, and we all know how that works. In War Thunder, especially if you've gotten up to this point, pulling out into the enemy's line of fire, while that may work in World of Tanks, does not work here in War Thunder. And what you really need is a decent reverse speed to get back out of trouble. And that's why a lot of players don't really like this thing. It doesn't have the armor. It doesn't have good reverse speed. But Miles, I can hear you already saying the FE4202 has armor. The FE4202 doesn't have reverse speed, so it can take the hits as it gets out of trouble. True, but the FE4202 does not get APDS. And APDS is critically important. And if you're wondering why I have modifications already unlocked on this vehicle, it's because I had a test drive of it, and I just haven't bothered to unlock it since the test drive because I dislike the vehicle so much. However, the Charioteer, like I said, is different because not only does it have excellent forward mobility, whereas the FE4202 does not, the FE4202's mobility is more along the lines of heavy tank as opposed to essentially like a light tank that you get with the Charioteer. And the Charioteer's got APDS, so you can penetrate pretty much anything you're going to face. Like, mouse, no problem. From the front, you can penetrate the hull of an IS-3. Granted, you have to be a little bit close to do that, but with APDS, since APDS does so well against sloped armor, APDS is nothing to sniff at with the British. So the Charioteer is a definite recommendation. The other recommendation, once you get through the FE4202, is to get the Centurion Mark III. And the Centurion Mark III, contrary to it saying that it's a medium tank, plays more like a, it feels more like a heavy tank than it does, than it is a medium tank. And the British Centurions are kind of famous for that, them kind of being a little bit sluggish, as in regards to how medium tanks go. The Panther II will outstrip this thing easily, without much difficulty. And it's funny because the British heavy tanks, up until you get to the Conqueror, all have, the three that there are, all have medium tank guns as opposed to quote-unquote heavy tank guns. So, and the Carnarvon is a radical departure from the Churchills, because all of a sudden you've got well-sloped armor, you've got a relatively fast-turning turret, and you've got actually better mobility than your medium tanks. And that's something that really throws a lot of people off about the Carnarvon. The Carnarvon is a better medium tank than the medium tanks are for the British. And the British mediums sometimes are better heavy tanks than the heavy tank is. So it's really, really awkward sometimes with the British. And the way to look at it is, the way I like to look at it is that most of the British Tier 4s are just medium tanks with different designations on them. The one exception to that is the Tortoise, and I will get onto that in a second. So, the Carnarvon and the Centurion Mark III, the Carnarvon you're probably going to end up getting first because it's the vehicle that requires the least amount of vehicles to previously to unlock it. However, the problem with the Carnarvon is that you're basically throwing yourself into a 6.7 battle rating without the proper backup vehicles for the job, unless you happen to have yourself a Black Prince, or you've bought yourself even better, an STRV-81. The Black Prince is an okay backup vehicle to the Carnarvon, however, being as it's a 6.0 tank, and it has APDS for the 17-pounder, at 6.0 it's kind of dubious whether or not this vehicle is actually worth it. I would say get the STRV-81 if you're trying to decide between the two vehicles. And if you want more information on the STRV-81 and why you should get one over the other, there is a video that Mike and I did a few months back, and again, I'll leave a link up in the top right-hand corner. You guys can go check that out. That video out. So, you got yourself the Charioteer, you got yourself the FV4202, and you finally make your way to the Centurion Mark III. This is where things start to get interesting, because the Centurion Mark III is literally an improvement over the FE4202 in every single way, except for raw turret armor. The FE4202's hull armor is only 51 millimeters thick, meaning that the long-barreled 88mm gun on the King Tigers will still penetrate it, even at that steep of an angle. And the Centurion Mark III loses a lot of that angling, but it gains in thickness, although it's only 76mm, so don't expect it to be stopping any rounds hitting it directly, unless you get supremely lucky, which can happen. The other thing to look out for on both the Centurion Mark III and the Carnarvon is the turret roof. And I'll show you what I'm talking about. This roof here is quite well angled initially. The problem is that right as you go up towards the top, it sort of flattens out. And you can see that the armor like drastically drops there in effective thickness. And shots hitting the top of your I'm just going to call it your forehead, will oftentimes penetrate you there through the top of the turret, and if it's an APHE round, it'll splash down and kill you instantly, because since it's exploding at the top of the turret, it's hitting the gunner, the loader, and the commander all at once and just instantly kills you. So that's something that you have to keep in mind as a potential weak point for people shooting at you. So keep a lookout for that. If you're that concerned about it, which, to be honest, I really wouldn't be greatly concerned. If you're that concerned about it, just wiggle your turret kind of back and forth. And if you're wondering how to do that, a decent way of doing that is to go into your gunner sight and just kind of wiggle back and forth like that. Because that could potentially throw off the enemy's aim. Alright, so you've got yourself the Centurion Mark III and you got yourself the Charioteer. And it's critical on these vehicles, on pretty much all of the British vehicles, that you get APDS as soon as you possibly can. Like, I would even consider getting it before your FPE. Simply because the APDS makes such a large difference in how these vehicles play, and they sort of dictate how these vehicles play for the rest of the time that you're actually playing them, that once you get APDS, you'll sort of forget about the initial stock grind on these vehicles, because the APDS is so much more superior to the APC-BC. And I don't want to sound like a twat, but that's just how it is. It's just, there's no arguing that APDS is superior to the stock ammunition on this thing. There just isn't an argument for it. So, once you've got the Charioteer in your lineup, and you've got the Centurion Mark III in your lineup, that is when I recommend you get the Carnarvon. Because now you've got two good support vehicles for the Carnarvon. And the Carnarvon, like I've said, is actually a better medium tank than the medium tanks are. It's got better mobility, it's got better maneuverability, it's got just as good a reverse speed. Oh, that's something else I forgot to mention. The Centurion Mark III is the first British medium tank with a reverse speed above 4 kilometers an hour. So, if you find yourself on a corner and an enemy tank rolls around the corner and you donk your first shot, you have the reverse speed to get out of that, back around the corner, maybe not always in time, but you have the capability there to get out of trouble if you need to, which is a huge improvement, I must add. Okay, finally, the elephant in the room, literally, the Tortoise. The Tortoise is, again, another one of those vehicles that you either love it or you hate it. Some people hate slow tanks. They just despise the fact that they have to be patient about getting to the battle. And some people, like me, absolutely love these tanks. I love my mouse. I love this thing. I love the T95 now that it has its APHE rounds. This vehicle is ridiculously powerful if it's used properly. The problem is that with the Tortoise is it's had a couple of issues come up. For one, in a recent micro patch, they completely removed its all sort of zoom on this gun. It's a 1x optic, which is borderline useless at long range, unless you are a very good shot, have a very good screen. This is definitely a vehicle that I do not recommend you play in VR when you have the reduced graphical settings, because you simply will not have the resolution to properly pick out enemy vehicles with this with the gun sight on this thing, which is a real downside for this vehicle and was a real which is a real problem, to be honest, because the Tortoise plays in one of two ways. The Tortoise was designed as a heavy breakthrough tank, much like the T95. However, unlike the T95, it can actually go at a still slug-like 19 kilometers an hour. It's slower than the mouse, but only by 1 kilometer an hour. However, I've noticed that this thing handles better than the mouse. It's just more maneuverable. Now, by maneuverability, I mean that you can change direction as you're moving without having to completely stop the vehicle and then rotate in the direction that you want to go and continue to move. With this thing, you don't have that issue. You can just keep rolling forward. So the other issue with this thing is that people have generally figured out how to fight this at this point, and it's got quite a few weak points. So actually, let's take a look at the armor viewer. So you've got these two armor zones on either side in the orange right there. The first weak spot is this area up here. Although these armor plates are 152 millimeters and they're quite well sloped, this area right here is perfectly flat. So a King Tiger will easily penetrate this machine gun port area. There's also the classic commander's cupola if you have APHE. And especially if you're driving a Russian tank, I highly suggest you fire APHE into this commander's cupola, because you will do loads of damage, and you will make the Tortoise have a very, very bad day indeed. And the last thing that a lot of people don't seem to realize is the lower glacis. The lower glacis plate on this vehicle, if you have a sufficiently high penetration round, has the opportunity to go back and either kill the driver and the loader. Actually, this is the gunner, my bad. The driver's up here. You have the opportunity to kill the gunner and the loader, or if the guy has a lot of ammunition in the tank, you have the opportunity to potentially penetrate through the transmission and amarack the vehicle. So this vehicle has its own. This vehicle has issues. However, if used properly, and by utilized properly, I mean angling, because this thing has a ridiculous gun arc, and I will show you that in battle. If used properly and by a skilled player, this vehicle is nigh on untouchable. And when it had that very good optical sight on it, this thing could just, it could sit back on a ridge, use its gun depression, which it has 10 degrees of gun depression, by the way, which for a non-turreted vehicle is very good, and sit back and take out people with this monstrously powerful 94 millimeter 32 pounder gun. Now, it only gets one shot, it only gets one ammo type for it, and I'd really like to see APDS put on this vehicle, although it really doesn't need it. The penetration values, as you can see, 239 millimeters at 100 meters is nothing to sniff at. This gun is superior in terms of raw penetration compared to the King Tiger's 88 millimeter gun. However, the King Tiger is still going to do more damage because of its HE filler. But again, the Tortoise has the advantage in the fact that it has raw penetration and slightly better muzzle velocity. Not by much, but slightly better. However, this thing is actually... the common misconception with tank destroyers is that they're all meant to sit at the back of the map and shoot people. This really shouldn't be classified as a tank destroyer. It should be more classified as an infantry tank. I think this is the last of the British infantry tanks. The Churchill was an infantry tank. The Matilda was an infantry tank. This is also considered to be an infantry tank. And the infantry tank's goal was to support the infantry. It wasn't meant to go faster than the infantry, basically at a light jog at most. However, it was supposed to be heavily armored, had a very powerful gun, a decently powerful armament, a weapon that they could potentially use to support the infantry in their breakthroughs. And that was the idea with the Tortoise. And the Tortoise, because it was armed with such a high-velocity gun, could engage and kill Panthers, I think, at about a mile in real life. However, this vehicle wasn't quite ready until the war was over. After the war was over, they took a couple of these things over the channel. and tested them against a couple of captured Panthers, and at a 1 kilometer distance, the armor-piercing shot from this 32-pounder cannon went through the upper plate of a Panther, through the crew compartment, through the engine bay. It took half the engine block with it and went out the back of the tank and buried itself so far down in the hillside that, well, they couldn't find the shell. Just to, that should give, and this is at a kilometer's distance, that should give you an idea of the power of this 32-pounder gun. And it's got a not bad reload either. With a good crew on it, like mine, it's got a 9.1 second reload. Now my crew on it is completely aced, so take it, so this vehicle is basically in the best configuration it could be. So now most of you are not going to have this, but for those of you who do, hooray! You know what you're doing, or maybe you don't. I don't know. But again, I really like these heavily armored tanks, and I don't mind being slow. However, if you do mind being slow, I would say take the Charioteer over the Tortoise. The Carnarvon and the Centurion, I'll just use the STRV-81, and I'll talk about this in a moment. The Carnarvon and the Centurion are both kind, I don't want to say jack-of-all-trades, because the Carnarvon and the Centurion, since they both share this 20-pounder gun, are immensely effective at taking out these heavily armored tanks. The King Tigers are not a problem for these vehicles, generally, if you know what you're doing. Panther 2s are definitely not an issue. Ferdinands are just easy targets because they've got flat armor. You will penetrate the front of a Ferdinand out to almost 2,000 meters, like I've said in the previous video. The Jagd Panther and the regular Panthers are not going to be an issue with APDS. You can penetrate their upper front plates without much difficulty. And you could do this at quite a long distance. So, the way you have to think about these tank guns is not as one-hit wonders unless you are going for ammunition racks. That is the major difference. You are not going to one-shot an enemy tank unless you hit the ammo racks or cause the fuel tanks to explode for some reason, even though your shell has zero explosive failure in it, or most of their crew has already been taken out and they're down to two crewmen, or you manage to take out a couple of them in a row with a collateral. So whenever you get into an engagement with these vehicles, it is critical to know that you are not, that do not depend on one-shot kills with these vehicles. Go into an engagement knowing, okay, it's going to take me two or three shots to kill this guy. What is the fastest and most efficient way I can do that? So, that's the mindset that you have to have when driving all British vehicles. How can I kill them as fast as I can, and how can I do it in the most efficient manner? So, without further ado, let's talk about the aircraft. I realize I've dragged on now for 20, 30 minutes, but this needs to be said, because a lot of people don't get the British, and that's the idea of this video. So let's move on to the aircraft real quick, and then we'll jump into some battles. Okay, so unlike the Germans, the British are not lacking in terms of ground attack aircraft and ground attack capability. They've got multiple aircraft groups to choose from. They've got light bombers, they've got Mosquitoes, they've got heavy fighters, they've even a lot of their fighter aircraft with the proper upgrades can be armed with these legendary 76mm RP3s. I just selected an aircraft that did not have them for whatever freaking reason. Again, I don't have very much in the way of aircraft for the British, so it's I'm not a particularly great example in terms of what aircraft to bring. Or in terms of what aircraft to have, I should say. However, I can give my best recommendations. So, my recommendations are thus. Either the Tempest with the 40mm Vickers is a decent ground attack aircraft because, well, what's wrong with two 40mm cannons when you've got armor-piercing rounds for them? And with that kind of penetration, you're going to be able to easily deal with the top armor of most tanks. However, unless you have the upgraded guns for them, their accuracy is going to be greatly reduced. The Tempest Mark V can also carry bombs and rockets, so the 1,000-pounders are not a bad idea. The 8 RP3s are not a bad idea. The British have a lot of options in terms of ground attackers. the Typhoon, the Firefly series, the Firebrand. I mean, although the Firebrand is not a very good... A lot of these aircraft are not particularly great in Air RB. Not to say that there are exceptions. The Firebrand is one of those aircraft that is just absolutely god-awful in RB aircraft battles. But in ground forces, it is supremely useful because of its large potential bomb load. So... You have to keep that. You have to keep that in mind when you're selecting these aircraft. Firebrand, not a bad idea. Both of the Mosquitoes are pretty good ideas to bring. Oh, whoops, my bad. Let's see. Yeah, 8 RP3s, and then the other one has the 57mm cannon, which with the proper ammunition types, well, it's basically a 6-pounder, a flying 6-pounder anti-tank gun. So what's wrong with that? And then we get to vehicles like, or aircraft like the Brigand. The Brigand I highly suggest because it's fast, it's decently maneuverable for a heavy fighter, and it gets 4 centerline mounted Hispano cannons. Now the Hispanos are not particularly great in terms of shooting and taking out enemy armor, but that's not their main purpose. The main purpose of the Firebrand is the fact that you can carry 16 RP3 rockets and 2 500-pound bombs. Which is quite the bomb load for British aircraft. The only other aircraft that even compares remotely to that is the Wyvern, and I'll get that to that aircraft here in a moment. The last aircraft that I know of to recommend, of course, there's going to be plenty of you British pilots out there saying, "Well, what about this? Well, what about that?" Again, I don't really play the British aircraft all that much, as you can see by my hopelessly under unlocked British aircraft. That I don't really play British aircraft all that much. So, these are the aircraft that I recommend. Another great aircraft that I recommend for basically all tiers is the Hellcat Mark II. The Hellcat Mark II is a supremely versatile aircraft. It's also the only British aircraft, to my knowledge, that can carry the Tiny Tim. Now, if they've nerfed the accuracy of the Tiny Tim rockets. However, if you could hit anything with them, it's a guaranteed one-shot kill. You can also carry 6 HVAR rockets and 2 American 1,000-pound bombs. And American 1,000-pounders are very, very good. You can also carry a torpedo, but for ground forces, that really doesn't make any difference. And you get 1,250 cals. And who doesn't like 1,250 cals? So, a very, very good all-rounder. It's decently maneuverable at low altitudes. It's not going to outturn any Japanese aircraft, but... It's maneuverable enough that you can generally out-dogfight German aircraft with ease. So again, a very good all-rounder. Highly recommend the Hellcat Mark II if you have the cash. And it's also not that expensive either. I believe this is just under 1,000 gold. So less than $6, essentially. Or maybe just over $6. So this is a very, very affordable and very, very good aircraft for what you get. The next one and the obvious choice is the Westland Wyvern. Now, in my Unicorn review for this aircraft, I basically stated that I'm pretty sure Gaijin... The only reason Gaijin added this aircraft was to give the British tankers an excellent ground attacker for all tiers from 5.0 and up. And the reason I say this is because the Westland Wyvern may not have the highest top speed, but it has the fastest acceleration of any of the of any tier 5 aircraft in the game. This aircraft just goes, and that's down to the fact that it has a turbojet or a turboprop engine, where it's literally an engine that has props spinning on. It's literally a jet engine with props spinning on the front. And this was kind of a thing for a short while before they quickly realized, you know what, that's pretty damn complicated, and, well, it has some significant disadvantages, which I'll get to in a moment. This aircraft is just, basically a rocket ship. This thing just out-accelerates. In level flight, this aircraft will out-accelerate a BF-109G6 diving on you from behind in level flight. That's how good this aircraft is without any ordnance on it, in terms of its acceleration. And this makes it perfect for ground battles, because you get in there, you dump your ordnance on whatever foolish German tanker, and make him regret his life choices, and you get out of there before their SBAA have any time to really react. However, because it makes such a distinctive sound, you could potentially hear it coming, so you got to keep that in mind as well. So, what do I recommend to bring for the Westland Wyvern? Well, I can tell you what not to bring, and that's the. And although it may seem intuitive, do not bring the armor-piercing rockets. Because all the armor-piercing rockets are, for the British, are solid rods. They have no explosive filler in them at all, and although you might hit a tank, you'll only do, like, unless you hit an ammo rack or something like that, which is extremely difficult to do with a rocket. Unless you hit an ammo rack, you're not likely to do much damage. These rockets were intended for shooting at ships, not necessarily for shooting at tanks. So keep that in mind and bring the RP3s, not the AP Mark 1s. You can also make an argument to bring the 3 1,000 pounders if you're a better bomber than you are shooting. You rely on bombs more than you rely on shooting rockets. This may also be a good opportunity or a good loadout to bring. It's really more down to the user's personal preference which loadout he prefers. I'm actually a better bomber than I am using rockets because rockets are a bit RNG right now. I can depend on my bombs more often than I can depend on my rockets. So, for me, I'll probably bring the bombs with this. So I think that just about does it in terms of aircraft and tanks. I realize that I've probably been talking for about 40 minutes now on this subject, and I think what I might do is I might split this and do I'll upload this first part here. Actually, you know what? Screw that. We're going to do some gameplay, and you guys are just going to have to suffer through the hour-plus-long video this is going to turn out to be. So, for those of you guys who like long videos, hooray! You're going to get a long one today. And so, without further ado, let's jump into some battles, and, actually, I want to mention one last thing. I'm sorry. If you have the Centurion Mark III, and you have the STRV-81, I would suggest bring the STRV-81. For obvious reasons, you get 3 missiles, and if you can learn to control those missiles, you have 600 millimeters of penetration on each one of those missiles. So, you are going to be able to penetrate absolutely anything that you face with the STRV-81 if you manage to hit them with the missiles. Not only that, but because it's an ATGM vehicle, it has a zoomed-in gun sight, which means that you are a long-range sniper with this tank. Other than that, there's really not much difference between this and the Standard Centurion Mark III, although those missiles do bump it up to 6.7 battle rating. Although, if you've got the Carnarvon in your lineup and you already bring the Centurion Mark III, you're going to be doing the same matchmaking anyway, so it's not going to make that much of a difference. So, without further ado, let's finally get into some battles and let's see how this lineup plays out. Unless you're willing to jump up to 7.0, where the Russians get some really fantastic vehicles. You know what? Okay. You know, I'm actually going to try shoot a missile at this guy. Got him.
The enemy tank has been destroyed.
And it looks like there's somebody else over there behind that rock, so I'm going to have to be careful here. 56 here is moving up. Ah, crap, they're behind us.
Got a shot on him from here? Need backup. Attention to the map.
So you'd be over there. Fortunately, the gun depression over the back of the Centurion is not very good.
We've taken the initiative.
Sort of true with most of the British tanks.
Attention to the designated grid zone.
Yes, yes, I hear you. There, Mr. Yag Tiger. Oh, I was just crap. I just fired a missile and wasted it.
Well done. Attention to the map. Yes.
All right. So let's see. He's claiming that there's somebody up. Oh, yeah. Hang on a second. Okay, there's a guy. I can hear a tank. Yep, that's definitely a Tiger II right there. So I'll have to deal with that guy. He's right over there. In a second. It's good to know he's there. You know, I kind of wonder, can I fire a missile up and over this? This is gonna be ultimate cheese if this works. Nope. Nope. Didn't work. However, I do know.
Need backup.
Uh-oh. I appear to be bugged.
Your team is ready.
Fantastic. Okay, well, I am stuck.
Attention to the map! Attention to the map!
That was due to the fact that I probably launched the missile up into the heavens. And it won't let you, and it won't let you control the vehicle. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Nice. I took out his gunner, and I took out his engine on the first shot there. Can I get a potential... Got his friend right there. We got his cannon range and horizontal drive. This is what I'm talking about with the British tanks. They're not terrible. I gotta know how to use them.
Somebody cover me!
That looks like we just sort of gave up right there. Uh-oh. Old guy must have tipped himself over. I wonder if they ever took care of that other King Tiger. Oh, somebody else is coming around this corner. By the sound of it, it sounds like a King Tiger or a Diesel Tiger. One of the two. It looks like he's driving, it sounds like he's driving away from me.
Affirmative.
That's one thing I really, really like about this Mora sound mod. They have accentuated the engine sounds of vehicles around you. So it's much easier to pick up if there's a vehicle nearby. Ah, there was a Yag Tiger there I did not see. Oh well, we got 3 kills, so it's not too big a deal.
Let's keep the pressure on. Victory is close.
Alright, it looks like what we really need right now is mobility. So I'm going to bring out the charioteer and show you guys a little bit what this thing can do. I will take less ammo.
Attention to the map.
Actually, I'm going
to
take 20 rounds. Normally I just say take as many rounds as possible in this thing, because you only get 25, so... You don't exactly have a lot in the way of options.
Attention to the designated grid zone!
Alright, let's see here. Again, this thing's forward mobility is quite good.
Attention to the designated grid zone!
Now, I do have to be careful, because that ME262 could potentially screw me up pretty badly.
Affirmative!
Crap, I was trying not to knock that tree down. What I really want to do is I really want to find that Yag Tiger that killed me. Not necessarily to get revenge, just to take him off the battlefield. Because the Yag Tiger is very dangerous. Alrighty. By the way, guys, let me know if you prefer the webcam or the non-microphone, or the non-webcam. Personally, I think I can record better when I just use Shadowplay without the webcam. I just get more consistent FPS, and it just looks better than it does with OBS, because OBS has a tendency to freak the fuck out, drop frames for no reason. Alright, we're nearing the place where I died. No, looks like that pink tiger that I was going after earlier.
Keep it up, and victory will be ours.
Here's to move down the road. Sorry if my sentences kind of trail off. I'm just thinking to myself. I'm trying to get some good footage for you guys. Like the, looks like these enemy heavy tanks have kind of pushed down the road here. I'm just gonna hope that the Yag Tiger has kind of joined them. Yeah, looks like the Yag Tiger has joined them. That's very good news for me. Because it means that unless somebody else pops out that is totally unexpected, which they could pop out over there. Speaking of popping out. Hello there, Mr. Ferdinand. How are you doing today? These new gun sounds from the sound mod are fantastic, by the way. Kind of wondering where that Yag Tiger went, but...
Attention to the map!
Okay. That's not good. Oh, crap. Is that...
Allied forces have captured
us. Took him out. That's good.
And victory will be ours.
Did good for that artillery. That artillery hadn't been there. There's a good possibility I never would have seen him. Oh, and it looks like we've capped out. Fantastic, guys. Ace game. First kill. Alright, well, that's not going to be the last one, obviously, because I want to get you guys at least two good games so you guys can get more of a feel for the British lineup as I would play it, or as I hope it's intended to be played. Now, I'm sure the astute of you have noticed that I haven't talked about the SPAA. That's partly because I forgot about it, and secondly because, well, if I'm going to put it lightly, the Crusader AA Mark I is probably one of the worst Tier 4 SPAAs in the game. That is not an exaggeration. It has a terrible amount of ammo. It has a very, very slow rate of fire, so it's very difficult to shoot down fast-moving aircraft. And even when you do hit, it's not guaranteed to knock them out of the sky. Until we get sort of flak rounds, I would recommend leaving it out. The only advantage it has is that it can kill some light vehicles. It can potentially kill Panthers if it gets close enough along the side. However, I would just recommend sticking with the Crusader SPAA Mark II. I really wish we had the Skink in the game. For those of you who don't know what that is, it's essentially a Sherman with four 20mm Pulston cannons mounted in a modified turret. Oh, and it looks like we have our first customer. And it appears to be a Tiger II. Got his cannon breach and horizontal drive on the first shot. That's something you've always got to do whenever you're engaging an opponent. You always need to take out their ability to fight back. You do that, and you are one step closer to winning your engagement. Now you notice I was going for the upper front plate there on the Yag, on the not the Yag Tiger, the Tiger II, and that is because. That is because the Tiger II's front armor was at a downward slope, so he was essentially flattening out his frontal armor plate right there. Angling your armor and all is good, but if you're on a slope, you are reducing the effective angling of that armor. That's a problem. Ah, crap, they're capping my zone. What kind of spawn points do I got? Not enough. You're gonna have to be careful of that tiger E. Those rocks right there are blocking my shots in the cap circle. Go on. Turn around. It looks like he's stopped. If he pulls forward just a little bit, I'll have shots on him. Come on. Come on. Push forward, Mr. Tiger. There you go. You're mine now, pal. Oh, and it looks like somebody else is shooting at me from my right. And it appears to be the Type 60. Oh. And remember how I said there was a tiger behind me? Come on, please kill this guy. IS-1, are you blind? Thank you. Oops.
Thanks!
And it looks like that is the G model with the twin 37mm, I think? And a Tiger 2P just knocked out that IS-1. Oh, hello there. Those ammo rack explosions are always quite nice. Oh, hello. That would be the Type 60. But he doesn't have the armor. Nope. What's shooting at me now? And that's a Dicker Max, and those are bombs. Well, considering I knocked out 4 tanks and got 1 assist on that life, I'm actually okay with that. Let's show off the Westland Wyvern. Because I don't think we're going to get a better opportunity than this. And also, we need to bomb that cap circle ASAP, so... I'm going to be able to easily outrun these Snookas, so I'm not even going to bother to try and dogfight with them. That'd be suicide. However, if they do get in front of me, I will kill them. Alright, so I mentioned that the Westland Wyvern has issues, that because it's a turboprop, it loses power as it gains altitude. Dropping bombs. Oh no, that's a tree. Hey, I got one of them. Don't worry, I have a backup. No problem. The question is, am I going to be able to get there in time? I don't think I am. I really hope that AR-2 drops some bombs. It doesn't look like it. I don't think I'm going to be able to get there in time, boys. As fast as this thing is...
If we don't do something fast, the enemy will win.
All these two of them there. Well... I got the Dicker Max, but... Well, I did what I could. 5, technically 6 kills if you count the Dicker Max at the end there. This is also a pretty good map for the STRV-81 because of its improved optics and ATGMs. It gives you a very, very good opportunity to fire some missile shots, which I think I proved in the last video, or in the last the first game, I should say. We're looking for our potential snipers. Ah, you see that out there? That is a Jagdpanther. This is at, what, 8 meters? And with APDS, I was going through the upper front plate of a Panther. Of a Jagdpanther. If that doesn't say anything about this gun, I don't know what does. Okay, for a second I thought that was... Nope. Crap, there's a Type 2 around. Nope. Never mind, Panther 2. Okay. That worked out actually a lot better than I expected it would. Huh? Definitely a cougar blitz in there. Oh! Crap, how do you think he took them out? Oh my goodness, there's somebody up on the cliff there. Kind of creates its own set of issues.
The enemy is winning! We're on counterattack! Enemy forces have captured a zone.
It's firing, I'm hearing. And I'm really quite concerned about the guy up here. We also don't know where that Type 60 is. Ah. Oh, that was a problem. Oop. I took out the counter, that's good. That means I can push forward and deal with this Google Blitz. I just turned an 88mm behind me. Oh crap, he's right up here. One guy up here, possibly two. Way too much ammo in the back of this turret. I mean, you'd think he would hear all the gunfire right behind him, you know? I don't want to call this spawn camping. I want to call it taking out the Overwatch positions. Whoa. That was a very large gun that just fired. Hope that T-44 can handle the movements.
If we don't do something fast, the enemy will win.
Crap. Got an M46 on the cap. Or the NSKA-2 that's near the cap. Now it is on the cap. I feel like I can hear a vehicle behind me, but I don't have the time to deal with it. It's an STA-2 though, so it can't be that mobile. M46 had one damn job and fucked it up. Oh well. Ace game in the Carnarvon?
We suffered a defeat.
I guess I'll just have to accept that. I hope that my I think that's gonna wrap up the video there. I hope you guys have enjoyed this episode of Lineups. If you go ahead and vote in the comment section on what lineup you guys want me to do next, it's probably going to be another Tier 4. I kind of want to get all the Tier 4 ones done first, except for the Japanese. The Japanese, I kind of want to wait another patch or two before I start to look at the Japanese 6.7 lineup because, well, frankly, there's only one vehicle worth playing, and that's the Type 60. So I kind of want to wait until the Japanese tanks come out of closed beta test before I kind of draw my opinions, and I really want to see the Japanese heavy tanks before I draw some definite opinions. So, vote on what you guys want next. Russian 6.0 or 5.7 to 6.7, or American 6.0 to 6.7. So, let me know down in the comment section below. Thank you guys for watching. Keep your tracks checked. Keep your binos in place. Keep a round of the tube, and I will see you guys in the next video.